Einstein's equations. So, in order to formulate Einstein's equation, I will need also to match to Newtonian gravity. In a sense, I can suggest a possible equation, but then, of course, I need to check that it reproduces in the correct limit Newtonian the Newtonian predictions. So, so let me start because now we are so we did all this geometry, but for instance, it's not completely clear, for example, how the geodesic equation fits with the non-relativistic limit. Okay. So let me start discussing the Newtonian limit. So what do we want to do? So basically, it's the Newtonian limit of the geodesic equation. So we want to. So if the theory we are formulating makes sense, the motion of massive particles is described by the geodesic equation, and we want this geodesic equation, in particular, to reproduce the acceleration due. In Newtonian gravity, due to the gravity field. So, so I want to take a non-relativistic limit of the equation. So, what does it mean? This is important also for later. In the sense that you know, it's not that when you learn general relativity, you're going just to forget about Newtonian gravity. So, general relativity is a total mess. Okay, so you practically you cannot solve anything in general relativity. So, you know, it's very important to go back as soon as you can to Newtonian gravity. Otherwise, so in a sense, it's very important to, in any case, to understand whether, at least to estimate the corrections due to general relativity on the Newtonian result. Okay, so don't think that at a certain point, okay, you forget about Newtonian gravity. So Newtonian gravity is fundamental, so what I'm going to do is something that reappears every time you have a system and you want to understand to which extent you can use Newtonian gravity and what are the possible corrections. So what does it mean, Newtonian limit? Well, first of all, Newtonian gravity is not relativistic. So in order to get back to Newtonian limit, I need that the speeds of the particle is much less than the speed of light. Okay. So I'm going to describe the motion of a massive particle, but only in the limit in which the velocity is non-relativistic. Okay. I also, it's not only that. It's not only that, because, so as you can imagine, so general relativity will give solutions which are complicated. For instance, the solution describing black holes, but our knowledge of gravity, the knowledge. The everyday knowledge of gravity is only related to systems with a very small curvature. So in order to take the Newtonian limit, you also need to take the limit of weak fields. So in other words, We never noticed until Einstein that the space-time is curved. So, of course, the approximation in which is very close to flat must be a very good one. Okay? So, the Newtonian limit, the Newtonian theory of gravity, will only be applicable when the curvature of space-time is very small. Okay? So, we also have to take this limit. So, be careful. No? So, this is not enough, because if you want to describe a non-relativistic particle, but in a very curved geometry, of course, you cannot use Newtonian gravity, because you also need weak fields. Basically means something which is close to Minkowski space. Of course, you know, this statement depends a bit on the coordinates, but you want to be in a situation in which curvature is small. Okay. And then you also want, not only, this is not enough, because as we are going to study next week, you can also look at the small perturbations around Minkowski space, which are not at all described by Newtonian gravity, which are gravitational waves. So in other words, so we also need to take the limit of non-relativistic sources. So in particular, so just to tell you what we are missing. We are missing that if I take, for instance, two bodies that orbit each other, as we are going to study, they emit gravitational waves. So these gravitational waves are just small perturbations of the geometry. So they satisfy this point. They are weak fields. But they are waves which they have no counterpart in Newtonian gravity. So if you want to use the Newtonian gravity, you need all you must go to the limit in which basically I would even say that sources are static. Okay, of course it depends on how good you want your Newtonian approximation to be. Okay, but let me maybe consider the case of static sources. Of course, I mean, these are just words, in a sense that each of these will have an expansion parameter, so, I mean, of course, the answer depends on how accurate you want to be. So, okay. So of course, here you will have corrections which will depend on the velocity over c. Here you will have corrections that depend on how big is the perturbation of the metric compared to Minkowski. And here you will have corrections that basically have to do with the emission of gravitational waves that you have to estimate in your system. Okay. So these are just words, but then if you want to be precise, you have to estimate what are the subleading corrections. But anyway, for the time being, I just want to take the limit in which everything is Newtonian. So I'm going to neglect all higher order corrections. I'm going to take velocity as small as I like compared to c. I will take only the first order in the metric, and I will consider static sources. Okay, let me apply these three assumptions to the geodesic equation. So the geodesic equation, you remember the structure in general is this. I'm looking at a massive particle in particular. So I can use proper time. So now, so this approximation tells me that dxi in d tau, let me put a modulus just to, is much smaller than dt in d tau. No, notice that you know, in order to formulate this equation, I'm already choosing a frame, if you want. Now we are basically in Minkowski space, but I'm choosing a frame because, of course, I mean, the statement that your particle is non-relativistic is only valid in a particular frame. Of course, if I boost the frame, the particle will become relativistic. So this is a choice that is possible, but it's not frame independent. So I'm already picking up a particular frame. So when you do this, you see that in this equation, the terms with zero here are dominant compared with the ones in which there is a special derivative. So I can just forget about this alpha and beta and go back to zero here. So this is the leading term. Again, then if you want to start looking at subleading correction, you can do it. Okay. So what about this Christoffel symbol? Let me write explicitly and use the other approximations. So the Christoffel symbol is 1 half g mu lambda, and then inside the parentheses there is g0 g lambda 0 plus d lambda, sorry, plus g0 g0 lambda minus d lambda g0 0. And these two, you know, again, here there is a time derivative. And this approximation tells me that we are describing a system in which there is some perturbation. The metric is non-trivial, but does not depend on time. Okay. So I'm considering static sources, which means that, you're considering the motion of a test particle in a certain situation, a certain background, which is time independent. Okay, so there is no time. So the metric will, in this approximation, will not depend on time. And also notice that actually, another approximation, now I'm going to use this approximation. So let me be a bit more explicit. So the metric will be Minkowski plus a small perturbation and I'm going to treat this as a small perturbation. Again, why? Well, because in Newtonian gravity we never noticed that space-time is curved, so better be that we are in a regime in which you are close to Minkowski, and we're going to treat this at first order in H. Again, notice that this choice breaks diff invariance, so I'm choosing a particular coordinate system to make this statement. If you come and you want to do a crazy coordinate transformation, so even Minkowski will be written in a different way, so there is no way to write this as in order to do the non-relativistic limit, I'm deciding to describe the metric as a small perturbation around Minkowski written in the usual coordinates. Okay, so this was to say that you see here, so this is, here you need to put first order in H, because if you put eta, the derivative is zero. So this is of order H, but therefore, this is a subleading, so I can take this to be eta. At first order. Okay. Good, so then I can put back into this equation, okay, to write that in this limit, the second derivative with respect to time is equal to 1 half eta mu lambda d lambda of g00. Okay? Alright, so let's write down these equations. I'm going to erase it soon, but for the time being there is this. Okay? Now let me write So these are four equations. So the first equation is d2 t in d tau squared. Yes, so you see that if I put 0 here, since this diagonal, you need also this to be 0, but for the same reason as before, this is negligible, because it's a time derivative. Okay, so this is equal to 0. Okay. So this means that dt in d tau is a constant in this approximation. And this constant, of course, need to be 1. Because you need to, again, you need to normalize the four velocity. Now, of course, given that the metric is non-trivial, the normalization of the four velocity should be g mu nu dx mu in d tau dx nu in d tau equal to minus 1. But now, let's look at the leading order in this, okay? The metric is approximately Minkowski. Okay, so this must be 1 plus corrections of order h. In a sense, at leading order in h, in order to get minus 1 here, so the metric is just Minkowski, so I need this constant to be 1 plus corrections of order h. I will neglect these corrections. Okay, so this is the reason why I didn't write, first of all, this term, because it's equal to 1. So now the interesting equations are these. But then, so this is just the identity matrix. So let me write just sloppy like this. Very good. Notice also that basically there is no distinction between proper time and the coordinate t, because we said that the two are proportional to each other. Okay. So I'm just saying that in the non-relativistic limit, of course, if you have a particle moving in Minkowski at non-relativistic speed, the proper time and the coordinate time coincide. So I can also think about this as this derivative. So you see, this is what in Newtonian physics is called acceleration. So it's the non-relativistic limit of the four acceleration. We have to compare this with Newtonian gravity. So in Newtonian gravity, this will be equal to minus di of the gravitational potential. Okay, so if you are in Newtonian gravity, the acceleration due to the gravitational field is minus the gradient of the Newtonian potential. So what we learn, so first of all, or if you want, this is the gravitational field, the gradient of the Newtonian potential. So now, finally, so we see that concretely, that first of all, we see concretely that derivatives of the metric, first derivatives of the metric, are what is called the gravitational field, so what in Newtonian gravity I would call gravitational field. Let me finish this. In order for this equation to work, I need to say that G00, I have to identify this. So in particular, G00, is minus 1 minus 2 phi. I put the minus 1, which of course does not enter in the derivative. This is the Minkowski result, but this says that in order, we are trying to build the theory. So in order for this theory to describe what we know from Newtonian gravity, we need to identify G00 in this limit as it's related to the Newtonian potential in this way. Okay. So, sorry, what I was saying is also that, okay, we see concretely that, again, the gravitational field is nothing more than a particular derivative of the metric, first derivative of the metric. So now, coming back to what I was saying at the beginning, you see that when I say that I can choose coordinates such that the gravitational field disappears, now it's a bit more concrete. So we learned that you can always choose coordinates such that the first derivatives of the metric disappear, okay, and if the first derivative of the metric disappears, you don't have, in the Newtonian limit, you don't have a gravitational field. Okay, so this is, okay. Okay, now what is the next step? The next step, so now we managed to connect the geodesic equation with the equation, the Newtonian equation that says that the acceleration is minus the gradient of the Newtonian potential. Now we have to connect with the other equation, which is that, which describes the source of the gravitational field. Okay? So we want to write an equation that is the analog of the Newtonian. Where should I go? Let me restart. So what I should save? Yeah, the only thing I think I should save from. Maybe something more? Maybe not. So I should save only this, which I put it here. So what we learn is that we need this equivalence. So now let's write finally the Einstein's equations. So the other equation that we would like to reproduce, besides the one that I just erased, is the equation that in Newtonian gravity tells me the source of. The Poisson equation, so given a distribution of matter, okay, so everything here is non-relativistic, so this is the matter density, okay, this source is the gravitational potential, this equation, and G is the Newtonian, Newton constant. So now, so this equation together with the acceleration equal to minus gradient of phi describes Newtonian gravity. Now, I want to promote this equation to general relativity. And now, okay, now we learn that phi is part of the metric. Of course, this equation has some problems in special and general relativity because rho is not a scalar, so rho is part of the stress energy tensor. Okay? So you remember, as we were discussing at the beginning, in the non-relativistic limit, out of the full stress-energy tensor, only the 0-0 component survives, if you go to the non-relativistic limit. So this was the limit of dust, so particles which do not move relativistic, they only have 0-0, so the energy density. So that's why in the Newtonian equation I only have the energy density. So I want this right-hand side to be generalized to Q mu nu. What about the left-hand side? Well, the left-hand side looks morally some second derivatives of the metric. Now, of course, so we know that the covariant derivative of G is equal to zero. So there is no doubt that we cannot take just derivatives of the metric. On the other hand, yesterday and the day before, we discussed the Riemann tensor. So the Riemann tensor is an object which is a tensor, good, which is built out of second derivatives of the metric. So we want to say some, we want to write something like Riemann proportional to T mu in some sense. Of course, we need to match indices, and yesterday I was discussing contractions of the Riemann tensor. I was discussing the Ricci tensor and the Einstein tensor. So, an important property is that the Einstein tensor, which I remind you is defined in this way, this tensor, yesterday we verified this, has the property that the covariant derivative of G is equal to zero. This is just a geometric quantity, is just a geometric properties which comes from the Bianchi identity. Of course, now you see where I go. Since I know that the stress energy tensor satisfies the same equation, of course, I want to do something like this. At the beginning, people were only putting the Ricci tensor, but of course, then Einstein realized that this doesn't work because the covariant derivative of this is not equal to zero. So the correct object to put on the left-hand side must be something proportional to the Einstein tensor. Okay? So the only thing which is left is to fix the constant of proportionality kappa. How do we fix this constant of proportionality? Well, we fix it imposing that in the non-relativistic limit I go back to this equation. So if this equation is the non-relativistic limit of this more general equation, it should be that this kappa is related to this constant. Okay, let me go through this. So first of all, let me write it in this way. Okay. So let me do something which is useful also in other context, so there is another way to write Einstein's equation, which is what is called trace reversed form. You will see what it means. So let me first of all take the trace of the left and right hand side. So here I get R. So I remind you that this is the Ricci scalar, which is just a trace of the Ricci tensor, minus, so there is one half, the trace of G is equal to 4, because it's so you raise the index, it becomes the identity matrix, so the trace is 4, and then you get R. And on the right-hand side, I get kappa times the trace of the stress energy tensor. So you see that this is minus R equal to kappa T. Okay. So this means that I can replace this equation to get rid of this. So I get R mu nu minus 1 half. So instead of R, I write minus kappa T times G mu nu equal to kappa T mu nu. So an alternative way of writing Einstein's equation is R mu nu equal to kappa T mu nu minus G mu nu. So remember also this form, because although usually Einstein's equations are given in this way, this has some advantage. So in some problem, for instance, since we are here, so what you read from this equation, you read that if the stress energy tensor is equal to zero, so when you are in vacuum, notice that it's not a trivial situation, because for instance, when you want to solve
for the metric outside the star, okay, it does not mean that you are in flat space. It just means that you are in points where there is no matter. Okay, for instance, if you want to describe the metric outside the sun, okay, the solution, the equation that you need to solve is r mu nu equal to zero. Okay. You need to solve this equation with zero stress energy tensor, and you see from this equation that zero stress energy tensor implies r mu nu equal to zero. Okay. Which is not completely evident for this, because here there is a combination of the two, but okay. So this means, something to learn, that in vacuum the Ricci tensor vanishes, the full Ricci tensor vanishes. Okay? So, anyway, so why I wrote it in this way? Because it's better now to, now we can take the non-relativistic limit. What about the stress energy tensor? Well, the stress energy tensor in the non-relativistic limit, I told you that it is dominated by the energy density. So if I want to reproduce this equation, I must go to the limit in which all the other components are negligible. So I'm going to take a stress energy tensor, T mu nu, which is just rho u mu u nu. But even more, I'm saying that the source is non-relativistic, okay? So let's go to the limit in which is completely static. So I'm going to take u0 to be just 1, well, minus 1, 0. Just a note. Notice that always be careful, because you should always normalize for velocity. Okay, now the reason why I just put 1 is because it is true that the metric will not be exactly Minkowski, but it will be Minkowski plus small corrections. Now, if I put these small corrections here, since they describe already the right hand side of the equation, I will go to higher order. So I need to take the leading order on the right-hand side to give the first order in H, and then there are some leading corrections that I can draw. Okay. Very good. So, let me consider the various entries. So I need to calculate these and these. T is the trace of the stress energy tensor, which is, since there is only T00, this is G00 times T00, but this is nothing more than minus rho, minus because this is minus 1. And then I can write finally this equation. Of course, these are many equations. Okay, Einstein's equations are 10 equations, because there is a these are 10 different components, so you start seeing that it's a complete mess. Of course, this equation will be the 0-0 component of this, because rho appears as the 0-0 component of the stress energy tensor. Okay? So let's only focus on the 0-0 component. So look at this. Sorry, I should have pointed to this equation. So I say R00 is equal to kappa times T00, which is rho, minus G00, which is minus 1, times the trace, which is minus rho. Yes, I get a mess. Yes, sorry, thanks. In fact, I was a bit panicking there. Okay. Thanks. The minus 1, where did I lose it? Here it was, I lost this 1/2, thank you.
Also, why we are not using our metric? I mean, this also equals to minus 1 through the
square. Sorry, wait a second.
So why we are not using the sum that we had before for this here when we were the...
Good. So you're asking why I don't reduce it? Yeah, yeah. It's for the same reason I was discussing before, but it's good. Because, you see, the left-hand side will be morally, well, it's better, I mean, if it works, it should be the Laplacian profile, okay? So the left-hand side is of order phi, and phi is small, so I'm going to take the limit in which phi is small. So you see that I cannot, if you want, you want to take here something which is 1 plus phi, so this would be a correction to this equation of this form, okay? But since this is of order this is subleading, right? Yeah, it's a good question. No, so sorry, I'm skipping some passages, but so this is a small parameter, and of course, given this is sourced by this, also this is in some sense a small parameter. So corrections to this will be of order phi squared on the left hand side. Okay. So I should keep all these, of course, if I want to go to higher order. Okay, so thanks to your correction, now I think there is some chance that it works. So there is a one up here. Okay. All right. So this becomes k over 2 times rho. Good. All right. So now we need to calculate this, with the hope that it becomes something similar to this. So the Riemann tensor is an horrible beast, but fortunately not in this case, because so what is R00? Well, R00, you remember, it is this from yesterday. So I have to trace over these two indices. Of course, this is anti-symmetric. So this means that I actually need to only to trace over spatial indices. Okay. Yes. So let me write before trace. So I need to trace over spatial indices. Let me write more generally this part of the Riemann tensor. If you look at your notes yesterday, this is. There is a piece like this. Okay, so you remember structurally. Then okay, you can look at the notes. But structurally, the Riemann tensor is derivative of Christoffel symbols plus Christoffel symbol squared. Sorry, schematically. Okay. But the Christoffel symbol is derivative of the metric. And since we are at first order, so this is of order phi squared. Okay, so the metric is 1 plus phi, so phi is small. So this contains each gamma is a derivative of phi, so this is of order phi squared. So Christoph, this can be neglected. This can also be neglected because we're looking at a static situation, or again, non-relativistic in a sense. Time derivatives are small compared to spatial derivatives, so this is negligible. Good. So now it's easy. So I need to calculate R0. I want to trace to get the Ricci. So I have to calculate this with the I. So let me write what is the Christoffel symbol. It is 1 half GI lambda. Now I'm explicitly writing the expression for the Christoffel symbol. Okay, so I didn't do anything, I just wrote the expression of this, putting this index to be I so that I can trace. But many terms drop because time derivative are negligible for the same reason as before. And moreover, since this derivative act on phi, I cannot put Minkowski here. I need to put phi, otherwise there is no derivative. I can also forget about this because this would be a higher order. So I can put just delta ij. Okay, so you see that, so now this becomes j. Okay, so you see that this is the Laplacian, is minus 1/2 of the Laplace. Sorry, I'm using these symbols just in this lecture because I want to connect to non-relativistic physics. So this symbol is the usual three-dimensional flat space Laplacian. It has nothing to do with the covariant derivatives. But for this lecture, since we're interested in the non-relativistic limit, it's okay. Okay. Well, now I'm almost done because we are in good shape because G00 actually contains phi. So this object is just let me put it together with this. Okay, so I have this equation. So R00, which is now the Laplacian so this is just the Laplacian of phi, so I'm not missing any factor of 2, I think. So there is a minus 2 which goes away with this. Okay? So I get that the Laplacian of phi the Ricci's tensor 0,0, which is the trace of the Riemann, has been calculated, is equal, using that expression, is equal to the Laplacian of phi. I mean, assuming that, again, phi must appear because of the, again, I'm using the geodesic equation, in a sense, no matter what it is, this is what should appear in the geodesic equation in order to reconstruct the Newtonian gravity. Okay. And this is equal to k over 2 rho because of this equation. So in order for this equation to make sense and be compatible with the Newtonian limit, I need the kappa to be 8 pi g. Okay? So we are very happy. I hope that everything is clear. I think these steps are very important. For instance, what we did yesterday about verifying the properties of the Riemann, I mean, it's okay, but this is just mathematics, right? So I'm not so concerned. But here, I think it's very important, you know, because each step, it's important to understand all the approximation that one has to do to go to the non-relativistic limit. Okay? And also because these steps are very important to fix finally the form of Isis equations. Very good. Any question? I don't think there is a better place to take a 3 minutes break since we got the Isis equations.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
We obtained the Isis tensor from the Bianchi.
Yes.
There is another, and we are comparing that because we have a covariant derivative of equal to zero, we are comparing with the energy moment potential. There is another way to get another tensor, a Turing tensor, which is the covariant derivative is equal to zero to compare with the energy moment potential. I mean, if the Einstein tensor is unique, or we can obtain another.
It's a good question. And I'm not sure if I want to tell you the answer. So let me give various levels of answer. So if you want something which is linear in Riemann, the answer is no. Okay. If you want, I mean, if your logic is, okay,
I see the Poisson equation. The Poisson equation has two derivatives of the metric. So it must be something inside Riemann. So out of Riemann, I must build a tensor which is symmetric and covalently conserved. These two properties only select the Einstein tensor. On the other hand, your question is very good, and maybe I think you may have done in the next course you're going to discuss about this, because if there is another way to modify this equation, it's a bit, I think it's not the right moment, but there is another tensor which has zero covalent derivative that you can add to this equation, and it is just as simple as so I can put this object, no? So this object satisfies exactly what you wanted. So it's a tensor, it has two indices, it's symmetric, it has zero covariant derivative. Okay. The only reason why you may not want to put it is because you want something with two derivatives on the metric. Okay. But this does not seem to be a good explanation. I think Merdad will talk about this. So this is what would be called a cosmological constant. Let me not say much. I think Merdad will discuss about this. So you know the story. At a certain point, Einstein himself. So this cosmological constant had alternative. Period of excitement, and so at the beginning it was not put in the equation because of the reason I explained. So everything makes sense without the cosmological constant, you have the Newtonian limit. Then, in the absence of this constant, Einstein was not able to find static cosmological solutions. Before knowing that actually the universe is expanding, so you don't need a static solution, then he started considering this constant. This constant does not really solve any problem with the static universe, so it was an error. But anyway, he put it in order for this. Then the universe, people discovered the universe is actually evolving, so this was removed. But actually, this is not a good explanation. So this is something that can be put in the equation. And nowadays, there is strong evidence, but this will be discussed in cosmology in the rest of the course. There is quite strong evidence that there is a small cosmological constant. As Merdad will discuss, this poses problems of fine-tuning, in a sense. You can look at dimensions. So in mass units, this is dimension 4, the stress energy tensor. This is dimension minus 2. Maybe it's better. Let's forget about this. So let's it depends how you define this lambda. But if you consider lambda as a modification, you can put. You can do whatever you want, but. If you think about this lambda as a modification of the stress energy tensor, okay. So if you think about this as an object with dimension 4, okay, something which has to be compared with the stress energy tensor, experimentally now this is of order 10 to minus 3 electron volts to the fourth. Okay, so this is an extremely tiny number. No matter what is your favorite particle physics model, this is smaller than any possible scale. I don't know what to say. I think there is a lot to say, and Merdad will discuss about this. Let me end up with this. Experimentally, it seems that there is a small value for the cosmological constant. It is so small that it is irrelevant for any purposes. Unless you're looking at the whole universe, so because this is a super tiny scale, so if of course any object in the universe
has an energy density which is higher than this. So once you put this, but you have a stress energy tensor, you completely neglect the cosmological constant. On the other hand, the question remains. So for a time being, I just say it is experimentally extremely small if it is different from zero. So let's forget about it. But the problem will come back. Okay, let's stop here. 3 minutes. Questions? So for the remaining time, I want to do two small things. So first of all, I want to anticipate what we are going to do next week. So next week is the last week of this course, and we are going to discuss about gravitational waves. So now, okay, I'm going to start next week, but let me tell you something already. So I told you, if you are in vacuum, the right-hand side of the Einstein equation is equal to zero, okay, which in particular implies that the Ricci tensor is equal to zero. On the other hand, Ricci tensor equal to zero does not imply Riemann tensor is equal to zero. Right? So this is an important statement. Just to be sure, the Ricci tensor has 10 independent components because it's symmetric. Okay, so these are just R mu nu equal to zero are 10 equations, but the Riemann tensor has 20 components. Okay? So what does it mean? It means that there is room for something even in the absence. So imagine that you have space and there is no stress energy tensor. So you are in you take the full solution, there is no stress energy tensor anywhere. Okay. This means that the Ricci tensor is zero everywhere, but this does not mean that the Riemann tensor is equal to zero. And as we are going to study next week, this allows for solutions which are the analog of electromagnetic waves. I can say the same thing for Maxwell's equation, no? So you're saying I put the current equal to zero everywhere, so I solve just Einstein's equation equal to zero, Maxwell's equation equal to zero, but the solutions are electromagnetic waves. So the same thing will happen here. So the solution of Einstein's equation in the complete absence of sources will allow for wave solutions. So in particular, we are going to study these solutions only when the wave is small, not only because it's much simpler, but also because gravitational waves, as we're going to discuss, are very small. Concretely, are small. So this will be the next topic. Okay. Yes. So this is what we're going to start next week. Now, as a small exercise, there was something that was left over from last week. So it's a small exercise, but I prefer to do it. Okay. Also because I don't want to add additional material, so I prefer to go back a bit to an exercise if you want. Unless there are questions. Are you happy? I cancel. Okay. Yes. So the exercise that I want to discuss has to do with an expanding universe metric. And it's a nice exercise because it has some physical result. So So what I want to discuss is the following statement that I want to study the equation that describe the conservation of the stress energy tensor, so this equation. So this equation is valid, of course, in special relativity, but now we understand the story, so I can write it in a coordinate independent way in this, but since it is zero, once I go to the proper coordinates, this must be zero. Okay. So I want to write this equation once in a specific case. So let me consider again the case in which the metric is the same as is what is called a FLRW metric. Okay, what kind of stress energy tensor I want to discuss? Well, as I already suggested, this metric is usually solved in the presence of a perfect fluid. And you remember, I gave you a general form for the stress energy tensor of a perfect fluid. So we did it at the very beginning. You remember that this is the general form. So back then there was eta mu nu here, now there is g mu nu. For always for the same reason, because if it is, it must be, okay, I don't repeat that, it's always the same story in the sense, since I can choose coordinates in which I go back to eta mu nu, since this equation holds when this metric is equal to eta mu nu, it must hold in any coordinate system. Okay, so the exercise is just to write this equation, for this stress energy tensor in this metric, okay, and see what are the result. What is? Let me raise the indices. So let me consider this. And let me write, now I want to write explicitly this tensor. So notice that G mu nu is the inverse metric, so it's the metric minus 1, A minus 2, A minus 2, A minus 2. Okay. So the stress energy tensor with upper indices, so I'm writing with upper indices because I have to contract with the lower derivative, so it's better to consider the upper index. So T mu nu is equal to, okay. Well, I forgot to finish because you should ask, okay, but you have to tell me what is the for velocity also. Well, you're not surprised if I tell you that I'm going to consider a co-moving perfect fluid. So what you are going to learn in the Merdad's course is that this metric is a solution of Einstein's equation in the presence of a stress energy tensor of this form co-moving with the metric itself. I mean, this is not surprising because, you're not surprised if I tell you that, for everything to be compatible, this four velocity must be only in the time direction. Because of course, if this four velocity pick up one direction, this will break the symmetry so this is rotational invariant. So you need the perfect fluid to be moving only in the time direction. Okay. So I'm going to consider U to be only in the time direction in order not to spoil rotational invariance. Always be careful about the normalization of the four velocity. I already said it many times, but okay. In this case, so the four velocity can be just taken to be 1, 0. But be careful that in general you are not allowed to do this. It's just because you have a minus one here, and so this is compatible with the usual with the normalization of the four velocity. So be careful because in many cases this is not the case. So you cannot decide the normalization of the four velocity is fixed by this condition. Okay. Again, for the always for the same reason, because if you go to the local inertial frame, it must be minus one, but this is a tensor, an equation which is covariant, so it must be true in any coordinate. So if this metric had something here, you are not allowed to write this as a four velocity. So this will not be a four velocity, it is not properly normalized. And this is very important, for instance, when I was discussing the Doppler effect, it's crucial to normalize the four velocity. So be careful. Okay. But anyway, for this case is very simple, and our four velocity is just this. So I can put it here. So the metric, so the stress energy tensor takes the following form. So it's rho. So you remember what happens, that let's go step by step. So if I put the pressure, I write this term is just this, so it's minus P, and then there is P times A to minus 2, P A minus 2, P A minus 2. Okay. Then I have to sum this term, so this term is only in the 0-0 component, because u nu is only 0-0, so it only affects this term, and this is rho plus p, so this goes away and you are left with rho. Okay, this makes sense, because you remember in Minkowski, we were doing the same thing in Minkowski without these time-dependent functions, and we are getting actually rho p. So now this modification coming from the expanding metric. Okay, so now I write this equation, and okay, it's an exercise also to use Christoffel symbols. So the covariant derivative of the metric of the stress energy tensor, sorry, is given by this. Maybe we should check this. So there are two Christoffel symbols. So maybe you can write this before contracting this derivative. You know? So I put alpha here. Okay. So this becomes this. Okay. Okay. So before contracting this derivative, this makes sense. Okay. So I'm acting on a 2-0 tensor, so I have two Christoffel symbols with a plus sign. So one is acting on this index, like this, and then you act on the other index, like this. Okay. Yes. Now, okay, just to say that now we can contract the indices. Sorry, what I want to stress, sorry if I'm pedantic, that there is one term in which this would become useful for other purposes, but it's important, maybe I will comment in a second, but for the time being, I want to stress that there is a term in which you get the Christoffel symbols contracted, sorry, the indices contracted inside the Christoffel symbol, while there is a term in which the indices are not contracted, are contracted between these and these. So check that this is what happens when you write the covariant derivative and then you contract the indices. I will explain why this is important in a second. But let's finish, first of all, the exercise. So let me look at nu equal to zero. So again, these are four equations, so I have to specify which one I want to look at. I want to look in some sense to the conservation of energy, or call it as you want, the conservation of the zero component of the stress energy tensor. Okay, so I choose nu equal to zero. Okay, but since this is diagonal, this is zero also, so this becomes d zero t zero zero. Okay, now I go here, and again, since this is zero, this also must be zero, so this also must be zero, so this is gamma mu mu zero t zero zero. What about this? Well, this is more complicated because there is gamma zero. Yes, because this is free, gamma zero here, but then here you can put many, so in principle there is a bit of anything, so there is, let me leave it like this. So if you look at, well, you don't even need to look too much at your notes, so what are the Christoffel symbols which are different from zero? Well, even without looking at your notes, more or less we know, because, first of all, you can look at this, no? So you remember the rule. You write what are the derivatives of the metric which are different from zero. So the only derivatives is gi, j, comma zero. So there is a time dependence of the spatial components of the metric. So, since the metric is diagonal, there is no mixture of terms. So the only Christoffel symbols which may be different from zero are the ones with two spatial indices and one time index. Okay. So I already have a time index here. So the only ones that I can have are ij. But since this is diagonal. Sorry, let me not use a strange, but let me write the speed. So it's gamma 0, 1, 1, t, 1, 1, plus gamma 0, 2, 2, t, t, 2, plus gamma 0, 3, 3, times t, 3, 3. Okay. Sorry, I didn't want to write I, because it's a bit disturbing. Okay? Okay, now we have to write explicitly these terms. So you remember what I was saying about this kind of Christoffel symbol? So I was telling you that there is this relation. That I didn't prove, but... okay, there is this relation between Christoffel symbols with the contracted indices and the derivative related to lambda of, you remember what this is, minus g is the determinant of the metric. Okay. I told you to look at my notes or some book, so it's not very rewarding, but I think it's reasonably important to remember. So here I'm going to take the index 0 here, so it's 0, 0. What is the square root of minus g? Yes, so Carlo says that it's a cube. It is a cube because, the metric is 1 a squared, a squared, a squared, so it's minus a to the 6, so it's a to the 6, the square root is a cube. Okay, so this is equal to 3a dot over a, no? Because it's 1 over a cube times the derivative of a cube, which is 3a squared a dot, so I get this. Very good. What about this? Well, this you have to remember or recalculate. This is A dot over A.
If I'm not mistaken. No, sorry.
It's, I apologize. It's A dot times A.
So this is something that you have to calculate. And we already did last time. Of course, it's the same for each direction because all the directions are the same. So it's A dot times A. Good. So we are done. Now we can put everything together. And sorry, maybe I should say also this is P over A squared. Okay, so this is so that's why I get at the end A dot over A. So you see that. So let me rewrite. Maybe I should also specify this is rho. It's written here. So the equation that I get is rho dot. Then there is this, which is plus 3 A dot over A times rho. So 3 A dot times rho. Plus, there are three terms, 3, because they are all the same, A dot over A times P, equal to 0. Okay, I can collect these and write an equation which is this okay. So this is a very important equation. This is the equation that tells me so what I should read from this equation, that this equation will tell me how the energy density evolves with time as the universe expands. Okay. So in particular, you remember that I was discussing that many times it is, it's a useful parametrization, and we discussed some example in which the pressure, maybe I should erase here. So I'm considering the case in which the pressure is W times rho. So this is just a parametrization that is very common in cosmology. In particular, W equal to 0 corresponds to dust, and W equal to 1/3 corresponds to radiation. Okay, but let me keep it general. So now I can put it in this equation and I get rho dot plus 3 A dot over A times rho 1 plus W. I take W to be a constant, equal to 0. Okay? This equation can be integrated. What you find is that rho goes as A to the minus 3 1 plus W. So this is something useful to remember. So this tells you, given a certain W, how the energy density evolves as the universe expands. For instance, if W is equal to 0, this says something maybe trivial. It just says that we are talking about a collection of particles with a negligible motion. Okay, as the universe expands, the energy density, which is the same as number density, because these are non-relativistic particles, so the number is conserved, the universe expands, and the energy density goes down as 1 over A cube. Okay. So this says that matter density in the universe goes down like 1 over A cube. So it's just inversely proportional to the volume of these of any box that you take. What happens on the other end if W is 1/3? So
So I remind you that one third is the case of a thermal depth of radiation. Okay. So if W is equal to one third, this is four because it's four thirds. Okay. So matter goes like 8 minus 3, while radiation goes as 8 minus 4. So this is. So first of all, let's understand physically. Can somebody guess why there is this additional power of A? So why a gas of photons rushes, as the universe expands, it loses energy faster than matter?
Doesn't it have to do with the redshift?
Very good. Very good. So this is something that we discussed. So we discussed that there is a cosmological redshift, okay? Which is the statement that the frequency of photons measured by commoving observer, but this is what we're doing. Here we are writing the stress energy tensor for commoving observers, because this stress energy tensor is commoving. So what we calculated is that the frequency of each photon goes down as 1 over A. But, okay, the number of photons is conserved, so it goes down like 1 over A cube, like in the case of matter, but there is an additional effect that each photon loses energy as 1 over A, okay, so there is an additional power 1 over A compared to matter. Now, I conclude here, so this is will be important, very important in cosmology, because it tells you that so if you look around, nowadays there is more matter than radiation in the universe. For instance, there is this buff of photons that is this cosmic microwave background, which is a gas of photons left over from the early universe. Nowadays it is subdominant compared to matter. But this equation tells you that if you go back in the past, this grows faster, so it decays rapidly in expanding, so it grows faster if I go backwards in time. So if I go backwards in time, at a certain point, there will be a moment in which radiation took over and becomes more relevant. Okay. So this is what distinguishes, so in the evolution of the universe, there is a late phase, which is matter-dominated, while an early phase, which is radiation-dominated, just as a consequence of this equation. And in particular, if you look at the universe now and you compare matter with radiation, it's easy to calculate when this equality happens. This is called the epoch of equality, in which the two are the same. So it turns out that in our universe, the ratio between matter and radiation is of order 3000, and this corresponds to the scale factor when the two were comparable. So equality happens when the universe is smaller by a factor of 3000 approximately. Okay, yes, sorry, just a parenthesis, but it's not very, very maybe it's something that I was stressing that there is this problem, so not problem, I was stressing that this term is related to this quality, while this term these indices are not traced. So the reason why this is important is the following. So imagine that I ask you to write this equation. The conservation, for instance, of electromagnetic current. If I write it in a general metric, including the Christoffel symbols, so this becomes well, I already did this, no? So you remember, I was discussing a generic vector. So this becomes using this identity, you can show that you can write this equation, sorry, of course, with the same name. So now you see that I already anticipated, but we are going to discuss with Merdad. So I already anticipated that the correct way of doing integrals in the presence of a generic metric is integral of square root of g. So this means that as in flat space, the integral of this equation is a boundary term. Okay. So I remind you that in order to use this equation, let's go back to flat space. So if you have an equation d mu j mu equal to zero, this implies the conservation, for instance, of charge. What does it mean? It means that if I integrate it, you get a boundary term. So you get that the variation of the, so if this is time and this x, you get an equation that tells me that the variation between time 1 and time 2 is the same as the flux across the walls. So in order to do this, you use the Stokes theorem. So you integrate, you get a boundary term. Okay. And this, I want to stress that this works also in curved space, because the integral contains square root of g, so this becomes a boundary term. So this equation also describes the same fashion, conservation of, say, the charge density. But this logic does not work for this equation, because this equation has an extra term. It cannot be written in any interesting way. Okay? So this means that this equation, despite being something related to conservation of energy, does not imply the fact that there is here the conservation means, if I have a region, the charge at the beginning is equal to the charge at the end minus the flux across the boundaries. This statement cannot be done for this equation. You cannot say something like the energy here is equal to the energy there and there is some flux, because you cannot write any equation of this sort. And the reason is that this additional Christoffel symbol is not, is what it is, but it cannot be written as in this way. Okay. And this has to do ultimately with the fact that there is no completely general notion of conservation of energy in general relativity. Okay. So energy, in some sense, is not conserved. Okay. Although this equation holds. Okay. Very good. So I stop here. Any question?
Just one question.
Yes.
When we obtain this, use this equation p equal to w rho in our equation, is there any physical w where it depends on time?
Yes. Yes. For instance. Okay. So yeah. Let me do an example. So imagine that you have a particle with a given mass in thermal equilibrium. So this means that at early times, when the temperature is super high, you can forget about the mass. So this particle behave like radiation. At late times, the temperature goes down and it behaves like a massive particle. So in some sense, at early times is one third, at late times is zero, this W, and then you can show that there is also some, of course, there is some transition at temperatures of order the mass. So this is an example of some change of W. So there is it's a good question, because again, there is nothing fundamental in this equation. So it's just really a parametrization. So sometimes it works, sometimes not. It's a starting point. So imagine that you have to, you don't know the stress energy tensor, and you make the approximation that it's a perfect fluid. You also make some approximation that these two are proportional, but you see, there's no fundamental reason why they should be. So that sometimes they are, sometimes they're not. Okay. Any other question? Okay, so next week we're going to have the last three lectures, and I will concentrate on gravitational waves.